Today, we know 2 weeks we went through the subject of offense and the Lord said, "Help my people to cleanse themselves of this thing called offense." You remember last Sunday, it's like a pebble in your shoe. You know, you may be very well dressed in the best sleek suit, but if you have a pebble in your shoe, your attention will be always on that little pebble that's irritating you underneath the sole of your foot. Isn't that so? And we said offense is like a pebble in your shoe. You kind of keep shaking your leg like this, and all despite an excellent suit, all that is attending is a shaking leg like this because of offense. Haven't you had that experience? Is it only me? Every one of us have gone through such travails, isn't it? Little irritations, yeah, and things. And Jesus said, "Woe, offenses we can't prevent, but woe to the man through whom offense comes." So if anybody gets near you trying to bring offense into your heart, please say, "Keep away, keep away. I do not want pebbles in my shoe." Right? That's about offense. And the Lord said, "Help my people to come out of offense, that I may bless them and make them a chosen generation, a people who will sing forth the praises of God." And this morning, it's about the calling that each one of us have, right? And I have titled it, "A Mystery to the Intellect, but Sunshine to the Heart." You like that? It's a mystery. It's something that the normal, fleshly, carnal mind, the human mind, cannot comprehend. How God foreordained and how He saw you in your mother's womb and even before, and He said, "This one is for me, and he or she is going to serve me." It's amazing. It baffles a human mind, and men will fight against this kind of teaching, but it brings sunshine to our heart as we submit ourselves to the word of God that is settled in heaven forever. Galatians 1:15. This was Paul, St. Paul the Apostle, the man of God who wrote most of a large portion of the New Testament, very learned man, and this was his testimony. Those of you who are new, try to catch up. I'll do my best to make it relevant to you. Okay? Yes. So here is a great man of God, a holy man, right? And he is saying something like this. He says, "God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me through his grace." And that was St. Paul's testimony. What's your testimony this morning? He said, "God separated me from my mother's womb and called me through the grace of God." Right? So remember, brothers and sisters, none of you here is an accident. And you were not here only by the will of your father and mother, but you are here by the will of God. You are a man and a woman with a destiny attached to you. Is that okay? Don't think to yourself, "Oh, I'm hopeless, I'm no good, I'm not educated, I'm not this and I'm not that." But you are a man and a woman with a destiny. God chose you from your mother's womb. Remember your mother? From your mother's womb, you have a special calling and a destiny in Christ. And it is all by the grace of God. You know, you may be struggling with sin, your family might think you're useless, different things, right? But remember, you are the called one this morning. You are chosen. I will soon show you from the scriptures that this is not just words, just to make you feel good and make you feel happy or make you feel encouraged. This is the royal law of God. This is scripture. And Paul, who knew that he was called from his mother's womb, he had a misguided passion. What was that? He didn't understand about Jesus Christ. He couldn't understand. He knew only the law, the religious systems of the Old Testament. He only knew sacrifices, every time offering goats and bulls. He could not understand that Jesus would give his life a ransom that you and I may be set free. He just could not. So in his misguided enthusiasm, what did he do? He became a persecutor of the church. That's a holy language. Actually, he was a terrorist to the church. he was making plans and conspiring to pull down the church of our Lord Jesus Christ. He was going to the authorities, getting letters, collecting information from here and there, and he had enough letters and authority with him that he could drag men and women of the church and to put them in prison, incarcerate them. That was what Paul was doing, though he knew he had a calling. So as I was meditating, I thought to myself, if a terrorist, right, who like Paul could be saved in such an amazing ministry, I felt there's hope for all of us. There's hope for you this morning, my brother, my sister, as the grace of God is all over us. So we are going to spend some time learning what it is to be chosen by God. So I trust you will help me, give me attention. I am not very clever and skillful with doctrine, teaching theology like this, but I know we all have to grow up. Will you say with me, grow up? Yes, we are all in a season of growing up. So we're going to look at St. Peter, the apostle, the great apostle whom we all respect, isn't it? Yes, and then St. Peter, he opens his letters to the church, okay? And in that first chapter, the first verse and the second verses, it's all about how God's people who come to worship him, right, are chosen, were foreordained, chosen before time began for that purpose. So if you think you are here, you are somebody dragged me to church, I hear people saying that, somebody dragged me to church, well, you were dragged to church, but by the foreknowledge of God the Father in heaven. And he calls the believers. Let's read the scripture together. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers. Now the church was dispersing because people were persecuting. There was a lot of anti-sentiments. You know, you are worried about what's happening in our country. It's nothing new. Nothing new. It was always there. So God always strengthens our bones and makes us not cowards but bold in the Lord. Is it good? We are not cowards. We are not going to run away when difficulties come our way, when some kind of challenge comes your way, into your family, a challenge comes, we are not going to run away, because this morning we are learning that we are a called, chosen people. Right? Chosen not by elders in a church, but chosen by God the Father. To the pilgrims, there are six nations there, Asia is included, you like that? Now verse 2, elect or chosen according to the foreknowledge of God, according to the Father's understanding. Right? We are chosen not by human will, but by the foreknowledge of God. Not by foresight. You see, lots of us, when we are skilled in our different career, you've gone through, then you know, you have foresight. You know, if I push this person there, it will work. That's foresight. But this is foreknowledge of God. Not by observation or getting information of how does this man conduct himself, not like that. But by the foreknowledge of God, we are called. You are called by the foreknowledge of God. Isn't that wonderful? And I want to tell you before I go any further, in John chapter 15 verse 16, our Lord himself spoke of the disciples and he says, and this is what Jesus said, you did not choose me, but I chose you. Rowan, these two little boys from the rainbow are always kept here as my two angelic guards. You know why they are here? I told you last time, right? John 15:16, Rowan and Dilshara, God, you did not choose Jesus, but Jesus chose you and appointed you, right? Appointed you, Sulochana, appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should remain. Why? That whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he may give you. What is Jesus? My emphasis is, God, Jesus says, you didn't choose me, I chose you. Will you put that into your system? Jesus chose you. Will you say with me? Jesus chose me. Jesus chose me. Amen. You are here this morning because Jesus chose you. Isn't it good? Are you happy? Jesus chose you, right? And just to make a message complete, 2 Thessalonians 2:13, the scripture says, St. Paul himself tells the Thessalonian church, Thessalonians, that's the church in that city, like Brookside is the church in Borella, that in Thessalonia, in a city called Thessalonia, that there were the believers gathering together. And he tells them, God, St. Paul says, God has chosen you from the beginning for salvation. I want to emphasize the fact that God chose you, Deltara. God chose you. God chose you. True, Ishani spoke to you and she helped you to come here. But God chose you. Is that good? You know God chose you for a purpose. I can't get over you. All of this last week I was thinking of you. God chose you, Deltara. God chose you even before you were in your mother's womb for a purpose of God. Is that good? Yes. And then, and I get to, even as God chose us, each one of us personally, you know, he doesn't leave us in an island here and there by ourselves. Then what he does? He baptizes us into one body in Christ Jesus. He brings us into one place, right? God, it's Jesus said, I build my church, right? However clever a person is, nobody can build his church. Out of people who don't know Jesus, who have never heard the name, who have never given their life to Jesus, it's the Holy Spirit that gathers them together and makes them into a small community. Into a community. Small or big, we leave it, but into a community of people. So 1 Peter 2:9, but you are a chosen generation. You saw that word? You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood. Now more people than one. One by one, they have been all brought together and made into a chosen race and a royal priesthood. A holy nation, his own special people, that why? That you may proclaim the praises of God who called you from darkness into his amazing light. Once we were not a people, but now we are a people. Once we did not receive mercy, the 10th verse says, but now we have received mercy. Are you with me, everyone? I trust I'm making myself clear. So it's the season for this little church family that meets Sunday morning 9:30. I'm not excluding the others who meet at other times, but for this, it is the season for this little church family to examine this great rich truth that we are the chosen of God. You know, examine it. All this time I felt I was helping you to get yourselves aligned with God. You know, put practical things into place. Give up the old nature and come into the new. But now it's time to go a little bit further and have the meat of God's word. We cannot survive on milk alone. Amali, is she here? Amali? Yes, Amali will tell you that she started with her fourth boy with little milk, breast milk, and then she got on to other milk, and then now she couldn't have gone on doing it till May this year. Isn't it? Only milk, now you are giving him solid food. Is that right? Yes, same way with believers. We begin little children, right? But every day we cannot go on taking just the milk of the word. We need to get on to a solid, more solid, meaty food. So Peter is telling, is speaking to the brothers and sisters in the church who have been persecuted at that time. There was a mighty uprising against them. Division was coming, people were speaking evil, doing all kinds of things. You know how, in a trial, the amount of voices that speak, right? So Peter is speaking to them and he's reminding them that they are the chosen of God. He's saying, steady yourself, Steady yourself. You are chosen by the foreknowledge of God. You are not an accident.